Now more than ever, innovative technologies are fueling change and sparking new ways of thinking. Collaboration between corporations and startups is key to staying at the forefront of these trends. However, finding the right startups can be expensive, time-consuming, and ineffective. But Plug and Play is here to help. As a corporate partner, you will gain access to a whole ecosystem of innovation. Discover startups that meet your tech interests. Stay updated on the latest trends and network with industry peers. We will help you during every stage of your innovation journey, no matter where you are and where you want to go. Get in touch today.
Back to the agenda. So we'll talk about Silicon Valley versus Agtech. I think this will help explain why, if some of you are having trouble fundraising in Agtech, this will give you some context for why that might be. We'll talk about working with growers. This is one of the key relationships that Agtech startups really need to nail. The grower or the dairy operator or the cattle operator, whoever you're working with in Agtech, this is the relationship you need to manage better than anybody, even the investors, I would argue, because this will lead to good investor relationships. So we'll talk about the discovery call. We'll talk about how to prep and process for that. We'll talk about the business model and the roadmap. This is going to be lean startup based. If you know lean startup, this should be familiar. If you don't know lean startup, you will know it pretty well after this hour and a quarter. We'll talk about the research and MVP build. You really, really do not want to go into an investor call or a grower call not knowing the competitive playing field in your segment. You just give them too many ways to cost you credibility, right? If they ask an easy one about a competitor, you need to understand that. Sorry? I thought we had a question. Okay. We need to research those competitors and then design the minimum viable product. So we'll talk about the build for that. And lastly, we'll talk about field trials and case studies. This is the last mile between you and your prospect customer, right? This is you doing a field trial with the grower and being able to publish those results out to other potential customers who are, again, growers, dairy or beef operators, whoever you're working with. This is the key. You want to manage that relationship all the way through. We'll talk about that. Then finally, I'll close with some resources that I can give you, including my contact info, because I am an Agtech startup junkie and I love working with you guys. I know how hard Agtech is as a space, and we're here to help as Western growers. So my quick background, we have a fifth generation family farm in Monterey County. We just turned 150 last fall, which was cool. So in conjunction with the 150th anniversary, we threw my mom an 80th birthday party, had a lot of friends and family get together. And it was just awesome to think about the progress that the ranch has made over the last just a couple of decades I've been with it. 3,000 acres of leafy greens, mainly spinach and lettuce that we operate with some of the folks you see on the right. 1,400 acres of wine grapes with the Robert Mondavi Company. And a 300 head cow calf operation, which is, I sadly have to say these days, just means we have more food safety challenges than a lot of other folks with cattle and greens in close proximity. So we work on that on a regular basis. I've spent 25 plus years, and if I'm honest, that's sneaking up on 30 plus at Silicon Valley startups, but I'm not at one now, so I leave it at 25. I was at eBay early. That was a fun run in e-commerce. Three other acquisitions, including Aptar. I'm an angel investor. I'm an active mentor to a lot of startups. So I've got both ag and tech in my background. I helped build the number one accelerator. And I think Sarah's going to try and take that title away from Thrive. I applaud that. I applaud all the accelerators. I think they all can help you guys get to where you're going as long as you understand what you're in them for. And I'm now the VP of Innovation at Western Growers, focused on two things: harvest automation and food safety, with then next-gen ag worker education and field trials case studies sneaking up as some of the most important things that we're doing here at Western Growers in specialty crops. All right, so Silicon Valley versus Agtech. This came out of an exchange with a couple of my good friends, Sarah Nolette and Matthew Pryor, Tenacious Ventures, and Agtech So What, the podcast. When Agtech startups struggle to fundraise, and we've seen that for years, whose fault is it, right? They argue that it's Silicon Valley's fault. I argue that it's Agtech's fault. We're now going to go to the facts, and you, the jury, get to decide. So Sarah and Matthew's argument comes down to this. Silicon Valley has really short time frames. Most of you, if you raised or know venture capital a little bit, the average venture capital fund has a 10-year life. They have to raise money for the fund, invest it, and close out that fund in 10 years, and then go raise another firm on parallel cycles, another fund on parallel cycles. So this makes it hard to invest in ag tech, because when you compare the speed of e-commerce and mobile apps and search, a couple of which I've been in those spaces over the last 25 years, you can get a lot quicker return in a lot of spaces. So there's a podcast that Sarah and Matthew put together. There's a blog post they put together. You guys will get this deck. You're welcome to look at both of those. I then created a response, and my response is basically, Silicon Valley is already creating billion-dollar plus companies at hyperspeed. It doesn't need to change to meet AgTech's needs. AgTech needs to take one of two paths: change to meet Silicon Valley's needs, or find other capital solutions. And you see my blog post there on Medium. So highly recommend all three of these resources if you have time to get into the Silicon Valley mindset. Sarah and Matthew are great investors at Tenacious. Very, very savvy about both Silicon Valley and ag tech and the reality of it. So this will give you a nice understanding of where Silicon Valley views the world and where ag tech needs to go to meet it. So here's the biggest problem that ag tech has right now as an investment segment. Take a look at all of these companies, right? These are the billion-dollar private companies, the unicorn club that's out there. These are all the logos that you see. And you can see down at the bottom the industries. So from big data on the one end to social and VR on the other and everything in between, you should notice that one thing is missing, right? There's no ag tech, agri-food tech, or anything on this slide that really captures the space that we're in. So that's the first challenge. Is from a mindshare perspective, ag tech is not producing a lot of billion-dollar companies because it does take a long time to build ag tech startups. Now let's take a look at 2021, a record year for venture capital. So in spite of COVID, shutdown, slowdown, mandates, hard to get face-to-face, how many of these Zoom calls were we all on, right? 2021, still a record year. So I'm gonna frame this up, and then we'll take a look at agri-food tech in a minute on a relative basis. So 2021, $621 billion in venture capital investing. That was over double the 2021 number, which was, again, a continuing trend of increasing venture capital investments because there are so many unicorns and so many good outcomes that are showing up. Now, the three numbers that came out of this report, this is out of, I think, CB Insights. I got these numbers from. I should have sourced this on the bottom. But it's 659 rounds valued at $1 billion or more. That's a 69% lift year over year, right? So even more unicorns getting created in all those segments. And 1556 rounds valued at 100 million plus, that's 2.5 times the number in 2020. That has generally been a leading indicator. This is the pretty pony club, as I call them, right? So you've got these $100 million valuations, and what do they all want to be? True unicorns. So to see 2.5x lift in the ponies and 69% lift in unicorns, obviously there's going to be some fall off, but the 2.5x, the larger number, is a good sign for the industry overall. And finally, because of all those valuations and because companies are having a hard time innovating in-house, the larger companies, over 10,700 merger and acquisition deals, again, up 58% in an environment where face-to-face just was not happening at the level we're used to. So very interesting to watch all those numbers go up. Just to give you guys one comparison, fintech, right? The PayPal, Venmo, Square, Stripe, you know, moving money around electronically space. $132 billion in fintech investments in 1 year. That's 169% year over year and 21% of all venture investments last year. So fintech is a segment by itself scored 132. So how did AgTech do in 2021? Well, our friends at AgFunder have some numbers in one slide, but I wanted to show you this slide in advance of that. These are all the unicorns from the first half of 2021. 250 of them were created in 6 months last year. And we'll see what the updated graphic brings. But I saw no slowdown on the back half of 2021. See that little bitty box down at the bottom, right? The agriculture box. That's the one unicorn that we got created. And I realized as I was putting these slides together the last couple of days, I realized this morning I actually did not get the agriculture name for. I'm not even sure which one that is, but that's the only one that showed up in the first half of 2021. So here's what's going on in ag tech. And then I will pause because I'm throwing a lot at you guys, but I'm curious to get your reaction after I show you these numbers. So this is the agri-food tech number, upstream and downstream. Think of upstream as close to the farm, up to the farm gate. Think of downstream as from the farm gate to the customer, either through retail or food service or things like DoorDash, Blue Apron, right? So upstream, all in $30 billion, right? So again, $620 million overall, $132 for fintech. Agtech, agri-food tech as a segment, $30 billion. This is where it went. Over half went to upstream, the close to the field. Under half, just a little under half, went to downstream. This is the Blue Apron, DoorDash crowd. You can see the deal flow, trending toward 2-to-1 for upstream, and that makes sense because I think you're seeing a lot of emerging companies on the upstream side that need more significant deal flow, and I think that's going to continue. The downstream side, they saw a lot of larger deals, which does counteract the last line on this one. The 1.6, that was a single deal, the largest deal on upstream, and the 800 million on the downstream side. But from a deal flow perspective, this is about what you would expect to see. So again, lots of investment on both sides. So with that, I'll pause and see if anyone has any comments or questions on the investment landscape. Not a single question. So I will just roll on then. Oh, let's see. Okay. Thank you, Guy. Very good. So we'll roll on. This is the venture trend that you see from 2012 through today. Massive lift up to that 30 billion. The one trend I'll call on here is this was the first year in about eight that upstream was larger than downstream. That's again because there was so much investment activity in the upstream. In the downstream investments from the last couple of years. So you can see the trend. It's healthy and up and to the right, all good on agri-food tech. And upstream, again, did take over from downstream. One last slide, depending on which segment you're in, you'll like this or you may not like this. This is a breakdown on the investments along two axes, the number of deals and the dollars in deals. And so basically up and to the right means more deals in that segment and more dollars in that segment. Not a surprise for those that follow the space. The two that are furthest to the right, the alternative protein folks, Impossible and Beyond Meat, very public members of this space. Their CEOs, very outspoken about their desire to take out the livestock industry with their alternative meat programs. As a cattle operator, I have to admire their marketing. They've done a great job. I would say some of it is marketing hype, and we'll see if they can scale those businesses on a continued basis. But they're definitely off to a nice start the last couple of years. And really, it's been about 10 years at this point. These are the classic 10-year overnight success stories. The biological space is doing very well with Benson, Greenlight, and Pivot. The interesting thing about that is you're seeing a lot of regulatory tailwinds for the bio space because chemistry and chemicals that get applied to fields under massive pressure from a lot of the regulators and a lot of the public, if you will. I would argue probably inappropriately so. The science doesn't support some of the regulatory action that's getting taken, but that's neither here nor there from a startup's perspective. These are tailwinds that are going to continue. Chemistry will be under attack. Biological solutions will be favored, I think, from the investors and from a lot of folks on the public side of things going forward. Meanwhile, two of the spaces I tended to focus on a little bit more because I'm focused on harvest and food safety, the farm robotics side of things, a little bit more lower and to the left, And then the farm management piece, which helps with a lot of the food safety stuff and tracking and traceability, way on the left. And unfortunately, I think that, that's a trend that's likely to continue in both cases, because again, Impossible and Beyond are getting great valuations. So are Benson, Greenlight, and Pivot. That tends to bring more dollars into the space. All right. So that's the VC trending side of the world. That's both general VC and AgTech VC trends and what's going on. Now let's take a look at the second part of the discussion, how AgTech startups can better prepare for grower interactions to increase the chances of competing successfully against two things. The other segments that we just showed you, e-commerce, mobile app, you're competing against those folks for dollars, whether you know it or not, and other AgTech startups for investment dollars. So let's see how we can get you guys started on the grower interactions, getting those optimized. So the key to starting the grower relationship is the discovery call. And the discovery call is not something you want to walk into lightly. You want to walk into this prepared. I would argue that spending the amount of preparation you would take on an investor call to know the firm, that partner, who they're on the board of, who they've made investments of, have they had public interviews? You know, if you're looking at Nolan Paul at Yamaha Motor Ventures, you know, you should know that Nolan was at Driscoll's. You should know that Nolan worked with almost every strawberry robot startup. You should know that Nolan moved to Yamaha Motor Ventures and had extensive work experience with George Kellerman, who used to run the Yamaha Motor Ventures fund. You should know that George left to go to Toyota's fund and that Nolan now runs Yamaha Motor Ventures, right? You should know that Nolan is focused on the same stuff he was doing at Driscoll's, and that his first investment when he joined Yamaha after a fairly controversial Ag Funder news article where he said, I'm not sure a lot of these startups in harvest automation are appropriate for venture funding because they take so long and they are so hard. 9 months later, his first investment from the Yamaha side was Advanced Farm, strawberry harvest, right? So another harvest robot company. So that's the level of detail I would expect all of you to have on someone like Nolan. How big is his fund? Who are his LPs? You want to know all that stuff so you can be as prepared as you can. You want to be as prepared about the grower side of the business, right? So what do they grow? Is it conventional? Is it organic? Is it dairy? Is it beef cattle? Where do they grow it? How much do they grow? What are their economics like? Have they done mergers and acquisitions, right? We see a lot of consolidation in the space. All of that is really good stuff to know walking into a grower discovery call. And before you get there, you want to have a first crack at a business model definition. You want to have your overview ready. You want to do your research. And here's what you should not do. You should not build anything before you really understand the grower problem. You should not really think about building anything because you don't know what to build until you know, and good guy, I like it. Here's why I say that. You should not hire a bunch of engineers as well. It's way too early, right? So if you're gonna build anything, the one part I'll give you, guy, and feel free to turn your sound on, I'd love to get the conversation going, is if you build things, like if you're doing a mobile app, you can build a wireframe in a half hour and put it out there. But if you build a harvest robot before you've talked to growers or even a prototype, I think you're asking for trouble. Go ahead.
I think you need a very simple demonstrator just to get the conversation going. Because I think if you say, you know, if you say what you need, some people know exactly what they need, but you need something to show, you know, you need a calling card. You need something to get them excited.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. Definitely having something to show is useful. The old Steve Jobs line, right? How do they know what they want before I build it for them? That's fair. And that's Apple, right? And I'm a big Steve fan from way back. So I get that line and I know how he used it, and it's totally fair. I think the trade-off is how fast can you build just a minimum viable product to show somebody to get it iterating, right? Because the whole point of this exercise is to your right, show something to the grower that proves you know what their pain is and you're trying to solve it, and you've credibly put together enough of a product to earn the right to continue the conversation. So I would say that's your goal, is show them just enough to prove that you understand where their pain is and that you've got a pretty good idea and a pretty clear line of sight into how to fix it. All right. Any other thoughts? No, I think that's totally fair, though. Having stuff to show is a big credibility, driver, if you will. So the business model definition, this is where we start, where everyone starts. We go to Google, we start gathering a lot of data on the problem you're solving. You know, two big areas, right? How common is this problem? If you're working on water in California and SGMA, Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, is driving more water regulations and more conservation and more water efficiency requirements, it's going to get more problem. It's going to get more problematic, and it's going to be more common as you go forward. What are the available solutions? Again, if you're doing things like harvest robots or weeding robots, thinning robots, you're going to need to know who's out there, who's in market, how are they offering the service, who are they selling it through, all the classic market research stuff that you're going to want to know. And this gets me to my next point. You want to have some friendlies on the team who can give you some advice before you go talk to someone like Bruce Taylor at Taylor Farms, Miles Ryder at Driscoll's Berries, any of the large cattle operators, or any of the great big wine companies, if you're doing wine grapes and water efficiency for vineyards. You want to have known farmers that you can talk to in confidence who will go deep with you and explain this stuff, whether that's relatives, friends, people you ask for introductions to on LinkedIn, whatever it is. You need some friendlies to help get you ready to go out there and sell effectively, right? So I recommend, you know, one of two things: team members, ideally founders that have ag experience. And I guess if I had to make one point on AgTech, I'm not a fan of single founders, two founders, three founders, founding team, whatever. I just say whatever you have as a founding team, there should be some really solid business financial folks on that team, and there should be some really solid ag folks on that team in your segment if you're doing agri-food tech. And finally, advisors, and I work with a lot of the universities in the ag tech space. Cal Poly, I'm an alumni. I work with the ag school down there and the business school. I've also worked with Fresno State, Davis, UC Merced. Basically, the local businesses that act as mentors for these universities, the university professors themselves that have led the research in many cases, those folks can get added to an advisory board. And again, so if you don't have the team members with experience, plug into those local networks in the places where generally you want to sell effectively. And I think that's a good way to approach this. And again, the whole goal of this business model definition is the basic understanding of the problem you want to solve. And the second one is the key. This is where I see a lot of companies falling down: the underlying economics and what your solution will need to do to be interesting. So let me give you guys one example. There was a really unfortunate outcome last year. Abundant Robotics was one of the high profile apple harvest startups. They were building a really good robot. There's no question the robot could pick apples. There's a lot of question about whether the robot could pick apples at the metric they needed to pick apples, which was 2 cents a piece. And when you looked at the prototype they built after 5 years of field trials, the progress they made in the fields, the progress they'd made building the robot, fundraising successfully for a very public $10 million from Google Ventures and others, $19 million total, they ended up in the Deadpool. Abundant did not make it. And I know the founder, one of the founders, well, I know the other founder a little bit. I know the investors. This was SRI, the Stanford Research Institute, spinning it off. This was Yamaha Motor Ventures, the aforementioned Nolan Paul, active from the Driscoll side at the time, and then the Yamaha side later. And their biggest problem was they could not provide a clear line of sight to the growers that they could get to a 2 cents per apple pick rate. And they did not provide a clear line of sight, therefore, to the investors that they could get there, because the investors asked the growers, do you see a clear line of sight? So again, you end up needing to both know both the problem and the economics, and then paint the picture for the growers and the investors. And unfortunately, Abundant, chasing $25 million to carry them forward, wasn't able to do that in a strong enough way to compete with other startups with more attractive business plans. And I'll position that this way. If you're chasing $25 million in Silicon Valley, you've raised enough capital that you should have the product fairly well dialed. And I'm sure Sarah and the plug and play folks who handle more segments than just ag tech, would have a few things to say on this one. But when you're chasing 25 million, it should not be half product and half go to market. It should be all go to market because the product is dialed in and you've proven it out in the marketplace. That was the problem that Dan ran into with Abundant. He was not doing a 25 million go to market raise. It was half product, half go to market. Couldn't outcompete the rest of the startups competing for those investors' wallets. So, any questions on business model? All right, let's move on. Let's move on to my favorite slide. This is the lean startup slide. And I'm going to guess that some of you folks have already seen this. This, to me, if you haven't seen this, this is the best one-page business model that I've ever seen. I use it all the time. I've used it with startups all the time. I pushed my Thrive Accelerator folks through this actively multiple times during a four-month program, and I recommend everyone get familiar with it. It starts on the left with the problem statement. Again, the top three problems for your customer and the alternatives. It goes to the customer segment side on the right. I would argue one and two are the place you need to start. Define your customer really tightly. Define what an early adopter looks like from crossing the chasm terms, right? Who are the folks that are likely to get there first? And then define their problems with as much detail as you can. So for the customer segments, back to the Abundant example, right? If I were doing apple harvest, okay, my customer is going to look like an apple orchard operator. They're going to be an apple grower. They're going to be doing at least 50 acres of apples so they can justify the capital investment in buying an Abundant robot. They're going to have possibly certain brands of apple, if I can only handle certain brands of apple, Gala, Honeycrisp, Red Delicious, and others. Each of those require a little different artificial intelligence and image library. So with the customer segments, define those really tight with the early adopters. Who are the apple growers in this case that have early adopted things like platforms in the past, things like weeding robots at the base of the trees, things like that. And what are their problem statements? Again, the key problem statement is I need to do a robot harvest that can do this at about 2 cents an apple. There's some other problems that fall out of that, but that is basically your key problem statement to solve. Then you build out the rest of the pieces around that, right? What's your solution look like? What are the key metrics for the startup? What's your unique value proposition? What's the one thing you do better than anybody else in the marketplace? And in this case, you're competing against both labor options and other robot options. In the case of strawberries, there's at least 10 active strawberry harvest startups across the dirt segment, the tabletop segment that's up to around waist high, and the indoor CEA segment. So know where you're competing against. Then you've got the unfair advantage and channels you want to chase. And then at the bottom, the economics. What's the cost structure look like to build the robot, get it into market? What does the revenue stream look like? Are you selling capital equipment or are you selling as a service options? All right, so that's a lot. I've thrown a ton at you in about a half an hour. How are we doing, folks? Questions, comments? Interesting, heading the right direction?
What about service-based businesses?
Yeah, so for service-based businesses, I would say same thing, right? So we've got in the harvest space, we've got a couple different models. FarmWise is doing an as-a-service subscription model. Stout AgTech is doing a buy-the-equipment model. So Stout would do this as I'm building a $350,000 cultivator that I want to sell to specialty crop operators. FarmWise would have the exact same customer segment and the exact same problem statement, right? I need to be able to do that at math that works for the grower. And then where they would differentiate is, and the cost structure might even be similar. The revenue streams would be very different. Actually, the cost structure would be different as well, if I'm being honest. Having to carry the inventory for a service business changes your capital plan, right? So when a couple of companies, including FarmWise, went from selling machines to selling as a service, they ended up in a place where you had to carry more capital because you have to now own the machines and get your revenue stream over time. It's an attractive revenue stream for investors. They love recurring revenue. That said, it's a lesser revenue stream than the $350,000 per machine Stout machine will give them, right? So does that answer the question a little bit?
I guess would you say that the service base, like FarmWise's, where it's a subscription model, would then lead to the same or more revenue over time than just the selling of equipment model?
Yeah, it's a really great question. And I don't have an answer to that because you don't see very many folks that are out there at scale yet that we can compare, right? So I think if I had to guess, I would say the market is going to be a large determiner. Here's what I'll tell you is if you're doing equipment, there's been a real sea change in the last 5 years in how ag operators think about their equipment. I think, you know, from my grandfather's generation down to my folks' generation, it was always, I need to own the equipment so that I can have control over the equipment when I need it. I need it for that harvest window. I need it for these weeding windows or whatever I need it for. And I like to have control over it. It was an ownership bias. And I think whether it's things like Uber, gig economy, shared economy, you know, Dropbox, where you can just host stuff up there for a bunch of shared, you know, shared usage, whatever it is, I think even the ag tech operators at scale are waking up to the fact. And I talked to Grimway, one of our big colleagues on the Harvest Initiative, Jeff Morris, and said, you know, Walt, I've come around. He goes, I'm getting more open to the idea of shared equipment and kind of pool resources, because I think that it's a better model in some cases, especially with really small harvest windows where you can't use it year round. So I'll give you one quick example. The Mondavi acreage that we have on wine grapes, we bought the Palanque machine for $350,000 for that 1400 acres, right? My sister has 80 acres of wine grapes about 20 miles south of our ranch, closer to Paso Robles, and there was no way that she was going to buy the Palanque. And for reasons I won't bore you with, it didn't make sense for us to try and share it at the time. We bought this about 20 years ago, 25 years ago now. And so she was looking around for options, and she ended up with the as a service option from a company in Paso Robles with the same exact machine, the same Palanque machine, only they were doing it at $500 an acre. So I think what the service business opens up for you, if you can offer both, is for the big companies that still want ownership, you can sell them a capital equipment sale. For the medium-sized to small customers, like my sister's 80 acres, and those are that represents a lot of vineyard acreage, by the way, is the smaller acreage sets all over the country, all over California, even Temecula, which is trying to take some of our wine status up in Northern California away, and rightfully so. Go get it, Temecula. But I think the challenge is without that as a service model, you'd have a hard time getting to my sister and other small vineyard operators. So I think startups that can offer both and give the flexibility to the customer to choose are in the best position. That's also the most capital intensive requirement that I can imagine, right? So, and then Sarah, you were asking, is there a place to download? Yes, there is a place to download this worksheet. This is Lean Canvas from Ash Muria. I believe it's leancanvas.com. I've got it bookmarked on my screen, but if you do a search for Lean Canvas, you'll see it. And there are also documents. Now, it's a $25 a month subscription to get Ash's product, and there's more to it than just this. But you can get this off a Google search for an image, no problem, and just start using it. Just have the document stored, have the data stored somewhere else. And yep, I think that's right. Business model, Lean Canvas. Thank you, Ivan. That's exactly right. That should pop it up. But yeah, big fan of Lean Canvas because it allows you, it really helps you to crystallize your thinking around the one key thing that you're offering and that you do better than anyone else. That's all the way back to Jeffrey Moore, early 90s, crossing the chasm stuff, right? You need to do one thing that you win at and define that in the mind of the customer. You know, back to Apple days, back to Steve Jobs, right? My favorite. You had the early Macintosh, you had the early laser printer, you had the early software like PageMaker and Aldus Publisher and all these things that were out there. And suddenly all that coalesced into desktop publishing so that what you see is what you get became a thing. Apple got really good at selling that combination ecosystem of a computer, a laser printer, all networked together to a series of design computers. And you know, for those that remember it, if you're old enough, I'm in my 50s now, every graphics department in every Fortune 1000 had Macs because the Mac designer team demanded that they have Macs, network them, and use laser printers, right? So again, figure out what your company is really good at, market to that strength. That's how you will win over the larger incumbents that are out there. All right, so we've talked about some of these issues, but as we think about the product focus, so now that you've defined this, and now that you're starting to get ready for putting product into play, who has the ACT background that's driving product and strategy? The investors, and maybe even your customers, are gonna wanna know who's driving the business side of it, who's driving the product side of it. Those are the two key positions for early stage companies. They need to feel comfortable that the person driving the business and the person driving the product are the right leads. Doesn't have to be a full-time person, but you better have a lot of regular access to them, and you want to have clear line of sight if you're going to need that person to join the team. When is that going to happen, right? I think every investor who's quality is going to force this conversation on you. Now, in terms of the actual product, that minimum viable product keeps popping up. Build the MVP with the grower economics in mind. I already mentioned Abundant. Their failure to build a prototype, they built the Rolls Royce, they should have built the Chevy. Their failure to build a prototype that was going to hit the 2 cents an apple mark was challenging, right? And it was challenging for the growers, challenging for the investors as well. So you've got some farmer discovery sessions that will help with that, the grower discovery sessions. Harvest Wiki, I've got the URL in the back of the deck for you, is another example. Harvest Wiki takes all of the Apple research we've got off of Harvest and puts it into a page where if you're doing apples, anything with apples, you can understand the grower problems, the use cases, the edge cases, and the economics in one page without even talking to a grower. So it's Wikipedia for Harvest Geeks, and the Apples page is the first one that's built out. We will be building other ones. That's an example of a commitment Western Growers is making to the industry to get this crop information out there generally available. It's basically a combination of Washington State University resources, the Washington Tree Fruit Research Commission resources, and some growers and subject matter experts all putting this together to help the startups that do apples understand apples before they even have a conversation with the grower. And finally, the roadmap and the economics should all be put together before anything gets built. The most expensive thing you can do as a startup is build product. You want to be as prepared as possible before that point. So, any thoughts on that? Product focus?
Could you clarify something a little bit in the first section of, or the first bullet of the team section there? When you say who has ag background that is driving product and strategy, I might have missed this. I had to step away for a second, but are you talking about, again, sort of somebody who is either on your team or a consultant, or is that supposed to be someone like specifically already in your team engaging with the ag tech sector?
Right. Ideally, it's a team member. Ideally, it's co-founder, to be honest. And if it's not a co-founder, are you able to bring that person on board at least on a part-time basis to drive this? Because I think from the investors I talk to, and these are the folks you'd expect. This is Finished Deer. This is some of the folks at SVG Thrive. This is folks at S2G. This is folks at, I'm dropping names at the moment, Kirkanian Radical. The investors are looking for two things, and the earlier in process they are, the more important they are, right? So again, someone's driving business strategy, generally co-founder and CEO, someone's driving product strategy. Could be chief technical officer, chief product officer, VP of engineering, whatever it is. In my opinion, those are the two key team members for any early stage fundraise. Someone's got to drive the business side who could figure out how to find customers and do it at scale. Someone's got to find the product side and what are we going to build and when and how fast to set up the product roadmap. And so, again, I think it's most effective if the person that owns business and the person that owns product are full-time committed and engaged. Having said that, I will tell you that Charlie Anderson with Burrow, who's one of the success stories in AgTech the last few years and pulled off a $10.9 million raise to do Harvest Assist and run the little Burrow down the rows. So it takes the product, it doesn't harvest, but it takes harvested table grapes back to the truck and saves the harvest crew from having to run that table grapes, that set of table grapes back to the truck. Charlie was actually part of Thrive before he left his full-time job. Now, Charlie was working an insane amount trying to do both, but there's an example where the guy who was running really business and product for a while was not even full time. 5 years later, classic overnight success.
Got it.
So does that answer the question?
Yes, it does. Thank you for clarifying. And by the way, per Sarah's request, this is Max Johansson with Nova Nutrients / the Secretary of Forestry.
Oh, okay. Great. Great. Perfect. Thanks, Max. Yeah, that's great. Yep. Yep. Sarah's right. Love to get everyone identified in Zoom. It certainly helps. Appreciate it. No worries, Brianna. All good. All good. All right. So we'll move on. Competitive research. This is a spot that I am passionate about because I've blown up way too many decks in the past on the competitive research side because someone didn't do their homework. And I'll just to give you an example, in the weeding, thinning, cultivating space, right? Stout Agtech is kind of a stealth player until their coming out party the last couple weeks at both the Tulare World Ag Expo, and in the press, and I've been on a panel now with their new CEO, Brent Shedd. But if you came to me at Western Growers and were bringing a weeding robot for field trials and or grower conversations, and I asked you about FarmWise, NIO, Stout, any of them that are out there, there's a dozen out there. And if you couldn't give me at least the basics on where they were located and what their focus was, that was a really big indicator that you hadn't done your competitive research. And as good as your team and your product roadmap may be, I'm going to push on that a little bit because I know Stout, and I know that Stout comes from Tanimer & Annal, one of the largest specialty greens operators in the world. I know that Jeff Antle is Rick Annal's son and grew up in the dirt in farming operations and knows this space as well as anybody, has forgotten more about harvest automation and weeding automation than most people know, and has talked to most of these startups in his, I'll say, late 30s or 40s over the last 10 to 15 years. So if you're not aware of what Jeff and his team are building, you are going to get beat upside the head when you meet them in the marketplace. That will frustrate an investor. So again, you guys all should know the top three players in the market today. You should also be on the lookout for those emerging players that keep showing up. Again, you saw all the funding data from earlier. You know there's more early stage stuff than ever. And unfortunately, reality check, you guys have to keep on top of that because the investor is going to expect you to keep on top of that, or they're going to give the check to somebody else. So in terms of the other research, what are the big companies that are out there? If you're doing autonomous tractors, you better know that Deere announced autonomous tractors at CES. You can't be heads down and ignoring that. Yes, it was CES, Consumer Electronics Show. It was not an AgTech show. I wish they launched it at Tulare World Ag Expo, but they didn't. But you better know that Deere announced that. You better know that Deere bought Blue River 5 years ago and took a thinning company out of California and back to the Midwest to do weeding for Midwest crops, because doing millions of acres of corn and soy made more sense than doing thousands of acres of specialty crops. And you better know that they now have Jorge on board from Blue River running their innovation team and now bought Egino and the team at Bear Flag for $250 million. So that's $550 million in investments from Deere. You have to know they're not going to stand still. They're going to take Egino's product, their in-house products, and build that autonomous tractor and get it out in the market. So if you're building an autonomous tractor, you better understand where Deere is now, where the puck is going to be as Deere keeps playing hockey, and you better build for that and beyond that, because they're going to outmarket and sell any startup unless you provide a really, really compelling advantage. Make sense? Any questions on any of that? So again, their advantage, know where they play well, know where you play well. And again, you know, your growers can help, right? When you get done with the field trial, when you talk to growers, ask them why they bought the solution. Don't assume and don't think that you know why they bought the solution. Let them tell you and then ask some drill down questions from that. Again, we've talked about the unique competitive advantage. That is the key. That is your beachhead into the marketplace. And will it still be a unique position when you get it to the market? If that's 2 years out and everyone's working hard while you're working hard, what's the landscape going to look like in 2 years? That's your job as a founder to put that together. So competitive research, this is 2, 5, and 9. If we go back to the Lean Startup page, sorry, clicking on the chat thread. 2, 5, and 9 basically are the key competitive areas. where you want to drill down on. So any questions about competitive before we get into market research? All good to this point, okay. Let's see. So in terms of market research, again, we've talked about this a lot, don't want to be the broken record, but you need to know the economics for the grower and the solutions that compete with yours. So to the earlier question, I think it might've been Brianna, if Stout is out there at $350,000 for a cultivator machine, figure out what you can do as a grower with that $350,000 machine. If FarmWise is out there with a, you know, 200 an acre weeding solution, what does that look like for $200 per acre weeding solution, right? So what do their economics give to the grower? How do your economics compete with that? And how are they measuring it, right? Per year, per acre, per some type of yield amount? How are they counting that? How are they bought? Again, I hate to say it, you're going to need to know your competitors as well as they know them, because they're going to have the real world data that's out there. And FarmWise and Stout meet in the marketplace fairly regularly at this point, and they're out in field trials together. So again, you're going to want to know the competitive landscape really well. What are you replacing? Is it labor? Is it another solution? In the case of harvest, thinning, weeding, all the robotic, the mechanization stuff, it's usually both. It's usually labor and solutions. In the case of food safety, are you replacing a test solution, a detect solution? In the case of a biological, are you replacing a pesticide, an herbicide, some other thing? Know what you're competing against so you know what the economics need to look like. And then at the bottom, I'll give you some research tools. I'll show you Shauna Day's most excellent market map in a slide. If you haven't seen it, definitely worth a look. She's with the Mixing Bowl, among others. The ag websites I find particularly useful. Again, this is in my space, specialty crop, harvest automation, and food safety. Ag Funder News, very good for keeping track of fundings, very good for keeping track of new developments. That's where the Nolan Paul interview was, where he moved to Yamaha and said, hey, maybe this space isn't very venture fundable, before writing a nice check to Advanced and others. And then Precision Ag keeps track of a lot of the goings on, big and small companies. I find LinkedIn to be fantastic. I follow a lot of startups. Happy to follow all of you guys to keep on track of this stuff. And I find the Twitter hashtags Agtech to be useful. Ag Twitter, maybe a little bit more fun time, but also good. And then for podcasts, I definitely like Bonnie Estes with PMA Takes on Tech. That is now IFPA, the International Fresh Produce Association. I like Agtech So What. That's the podcast I mentioned earlier with Sarah Nolette and Matthew Pryor. And then Business of Agriculture, Damian Mason, a dairy and row crop kid from the Midwest who now winters in Arizona. Fantastic voice for agriculture. Damian's great. And what is, sorry, this is hiding the bottom of my screen. Oh, yes, I do have a list at the end of this slide deck to show you, so you can see all those on the resource slide. So here's the market map I mentioned. And this is a great point to do competitive research, because you find your segment, whether it's field monitoring, precision applications, crop and farm management software. Shauna's entire purpose in putting this together for Better Food Ventures was so that investors and startups and ag companies could know who's out there doing what. So this thing's updated yearly. It gets bigger each year. They've had to segment it out at this point. There's one on just controlled environment ag. And I think there's one on just the middleware space, if you will, between the farm and the retail. So that between the farm gate on the way to the store, that messy middle, as Shauna calls it. So there's multiple market maps out there. Find the one that's appropriate to your solution and dive into it. It will give you some great places to start. I'd be surprised if you know every company on here, because look at the sheer volume of them, right? It's kind of overwhelming. So again, market maps, great place to do some research. Any questions on market maps? Any tips, any solutions, anything people have seen out there they wanna offer or share? All right. So after doing all this, now you're ready for that discovery call with the grower, the cattle operator, the dairy operator. And now you come armed. now you're ready, right? That same level of prep that you put in for an investor call, you've now put into a grower discovery call. You want to now ask as many questions as you can. You want to let them talk and you're right. Right. So the one thing that I will say, and it's the sub point on the main point, is go deep, not wide. So as soon as you hear the target customer explain their problem, ask why three or four times, just to really drill down. And again, I'll give you another example back to abundant. One of the things that they failed to recognize the strategic importance of was, for anybody who's seen apple bins, the apple bins will store apples. And I didn't realize this. The specialty crop operators are focused on the fresh fruit and veg that feeds the world and delivers all that healthy food. All good on the specialty crop operator side. Apples take a long time, right? Much of this food, we spend our time optimizing the time that it gets to the table so that it's from the field through the supply chain to a retailer or a restaurant in as fast a time as possible, so it's as fresh as possible when it's consumed. Apples are different. Apples that are picked in the late summer up in Yakima, and I've seen some of the processing facilities, they are massive, they are impressive. They actually get stored in bins, 1,000 apples at a time, for months in a cool environment. They then come back out to the market, get sorted, and go to market. So if you're doing an apple picking robot, an apple harvest robot, and you don't understand that you have to be able to touch the apple once when you harvest it and drop it into that 1,000 apple bin without what they call double touch, you're in trouble, because that second touch to get it from whatever container you put it in into the bin is now a cost for the grower and is now an extra source of potential nicks, scrapes, cuts, and culls, right? And if you cull apples, you lose them from the yield effectively. So that was one of the challenges Abundant had, is not recognizing the importance of those bins, which go from the fields to the pack centers, to the trucks, to the customers, is a problem, right? And so again, you need to ask as many questions as you can, drill down as often as you can to really understand the problem, find the pain, and then build the MVP around that. So what do you need to build? What's the minimum viable product that you need to build to, again, as was mentioned earlier, show the grower something, right? So any questions on that slide? Sarah, I feel like we've put them to sleep. We don't have enough questions today.
Don't be shy, you guys.
All right. Exactly. So on the MVP build, so now you're ready to design the build. You know, again, don't skip anything to get here. And the MVP can vary heavily. So if you're building a software solution, that's a much easier build. If you're building a hardware solution, you may not want to go to full prototype. I've seen a number of solutions the last couple of years where they literally just show off the end effector, the picking instrument for a harvester, or the cutting instrument from a weeder or thinner. They'll just show off the implement on the end of a standard robot instead of building everything else around it. So it's a standard robot arm. Maybe it's even stationary just to show off the functionality. So again, you guys will decide how far down the product path you need to get to show off an MVP. It'll depend on the growers, it'll depend on the space, and it'll depend, to be honest, on who's already out there. If somebody's got a good solution in market, you're gonna probably wanna show that you can get ahead of that in the marketplace. So again, the competitive stuff comes into bear. All right, so the last step in the grower conversation, and probably the most important, is the field trial. So at this point, you've done all the work we've covered in the slides. You've got your team together, you understand the problem, you've built an MVP, you've gotten it into a position where it's ready for a field trial. This is a field trial in a live environment. A live dairy, a live beef cattle operation, a live planting environment. You are impacting the grower or the livestock operator's business directly at this point. This is a big deal. And what I will tell you is, we've run some early math with Grimway and some other partners. When you ask an operator for a field trial, when you look at their resource commitment in terms of setting up the acreage, getting you the people to work with, measuring all the stuff we're going to talk about on this slide, you're asking that grower to give you $125,000 of hard costs. employee costs and operating costs. It's a significant investment for an operator to give you a field trial. Don't lose sight of that, right? If you're going to ask for it, make sure you're ready and make sure you know what you're asking for and make sure you can knock down the stuff on this slide, right? The first thing is, how are we going to measure this? And how can we get a baseline for that data? Because if you don't have that, you're never going to be able to determine success or no success, right? So talk to the grower at length. Talk to the person on the grower's team who's going to be operating the field trial with you. Figure out what that metric is. Take the time to measure it. If this means you start the grower conversation with the field trial in March and you don't do the field trial until April or May, that's completely fine. Do it on their timetable. Understand all of these metrics. Understand what they're counting and then work with them to get that baseline so you can agree. Here's how we do it now. Here's what that costs us. And here's what we're going to measure against in this 2-week window and then get a pre and post, right? Now, the other sales tactic that I always like to recommend is when you can, pre-negotiate the purchase at the end of the field trial, right? If it goes well, you should already have the value determination in the mind of the grower. So if you can get to a pre-negotiated price, it makes the post-field trial easier when it executes well. Then execute the field trial and count the results. And if it goes well, awesome. Keep it going. Get the sales process engaged. And then get the case study out there. This is the number one way you can get prospects interested in your product, showing them, hey, a grower, an operator that looks like you just worked with us. This was the math on their solution. We're rolling out case studies in earnest this year at Western Growers. We're doing our first one. It goes live this month on vacuum-packed cooling operations for the cold chain. So getting those leafy greens in Salinas Valley and other places into that cold chain more efficiently with automation and sensors is going to really improve the efficiency of those. Now, that's not as cool to a lot of the Agtech media as another Impossible Burger or Beyond Beef Burger, right? Or some of the Pivot Bio stuff. But to a greens operator, it's 100% awesome to see 20% lift in efficiency because you can turn the cold chain off quicker and turn the vacuum off quicker and save yourself energy and labor in doing all that with some automated sensors, right? So in their case, the field trial was implementing the solution around the vacuum cool and putting the sensors and the data tracking in there to alert and then turn off stuff automatically. So that's going to be a really great case study. Look for more of those. We're investing in that in a pretty big way this year because we know that growers don't want to run field trials for every startup. They would rather run field trials and get case studies shared back from other growers. So any question on field trials, this is a big milestone when you get one. Do not waste it. All right. Final slide. I think actually one more behind this. So supporting resources, you have my contact info, wduflock@wga.com. You have my mobile number. People always go, why do you give that out to so many people? I've been doing it since eBay. Nobody's really abused it. So, you know, if you have questions, if you have thoughts, if you have strategy considerations, happy to talk you through it. My blog is there, the Agri-Food Tech Alchemy blog. I'm writing less. This job is keeping me busier than the previous jobs, but I am out there. I'm also very active on LinkedIn. I try to be more active. You can never be active enough. It's stuff's happening all the time. The couple of posts that I'll point you specifically at, the financial template for sales and marketing. The Sarah Nolette Matthew Pryor post on Silicon Valley versus Agtech, that's got around 3,000 views, which for an Agtech blog on Medium is pretty solid over the last couple of weeks. The financial template for sales and marketing, and there's a part two link at the end of that Medium post, that is a template for all of you to use. It's got about 2,800 looks at it. That is basically to make sure that your tops-down math and your bottoms-up math ties. So if you've ever had the question, well, you're going to generate $20 million in sales in year two, how big is your sales team going to look like? What's that going to cost and what kind of quotas are they going to have? That post will help you build that sales and marketing team in a way that the math ties together, in a way that investors will have a much harder time blowing it up. Because I've blown up a lot of models that can do tops-down math, but then don't tie to the right size sales team and the right spend level against that to justify to earn the revenue, if that makes sense. So check out the fundraising decks piece. There's a two-parter. There's the spreadsheet. There's a Google Doc at the end you are welcome to use. I've got a mega trends in AgTech that sadly is about a year old now. I could update it, but that gives you some context for a lot of my blog posts. And then the blog post that created this doc that's got some more context is at the bottom. The, you know, this came out of a panel presentation, ironically, with Pam Marone from Marone Bio and Stuart Wolf from Wolf Farming, a massive specialty crop operator in the San Joaquin Valley, where we said, you know, we are answering the same questions for the same startups multiple times. We should really just put this together and put it out there. So you guys are the beneficiaries of Stuart and Pam's and my work, and then me turning it into a deck that they liked. That's basically today's presentation, less the investment stuff on the front end.
Yeah.
And last slide, I've talked about a lot of this stuff. I won't read it to you guys, but basically these are the things I'm focused on. The Global Harvest Initiative, you can see where that is. I mentioned the Apples page and the main page, the Common Modular Architecture. If you're doing automation, these are Lego blocks for automation solution in AgTech. And we just released the first report at Tulare a couple of weeks ago. And the Next Gen Ag Worker, it's not to get you excited now, but when you guys are doing A and B rounds in a couple of years, we're going to try and put 3,000 AgTech ready California Community College grads into the marketplace the next 4 years by working with growers and working with the community colleges that are AgTech based. And there are 35 to 40 of them in California to get the right type of employees out there, because Bruce Taylor at Taylor Farms, Miles Ryder at Driscoll's, all our big board members and our big members, they've been clear, as has John Deere and their dealers like RDO, that not only do you guys need these ag tech workers, they need these ag tech workers. So we're working hard on making that happen. So with that, I will stop sharing. You will all get a copy of this deck, and I will ask for questions. And I see one here. Good strategies for identifying trial partners and gaining access. Yes, find an early adopter if you can, and work with someone like Western Growers or Plug and Play to figure out how to get access to that grower. So again, if it's specialty crops, come see us. If it's Midwest crops, go see Sarah and the team in the Midwest. I will recommend Pete Nelson and Ag Launch. They are tremendous. They do a great job on this stuff. Pete's worked with multiple startups that I've overlapped with, including Grow Guru, who's doing some irrigation stuff out in the Midwest. So I would say, yes, find your way to a grower. And if you have a target grower, get into that grower's organization. Absolutely. All right, what is?
This was fantastic, Walt. So thank you for sharing such good information.
Of course. I like COVID. The appropriate use of copious.
Yeah. Does anyone else have any questions? Feel free to turn your cameras on if you want, or ask yourself.
Hey, well, what is, I saw your post about the FIRA conference in October. And I'd sent you a message about it on LinkedIn. Is that something that we could be a part of? And can you kind of let us know what that's going to include?
Yeah, 100%. It's called FIRA USA. And it's an extension of a partnership that we have with the FIRA folks, the French robotics group. And they do World FIRA in December, which I highly recommend. It's a kind of global gathering on a lot of the robot solutions for all crop types, to be honest. And Europe leads in a lot of categories. So we work with FIRA and University of California Ag Natural Resources, Gabe Yahtzee's team, to put together a three-day specialty crop robots and mechanization conference for just specialty crop robotics. Because believe it or not, there is no conference dedicated to this. It's always been in the conferences for specialty crops or the ag tech conferences. So it's basically a three-day conference, 1 day of R&D, 1 day of commercialization, 1 day of field trials. And we would absolutely welcome any of you guys participating that are doing specialty crops. There will be an exhibit area. There will be field trials and demos on day three. It'll be at the Fresno Convention Center and at Fresno State. And it's October 18th to the 20th. Sarah, I'll throw you, I'll put a couple links in an email to you, but no, we'd welcome you guys coming. I think it'll be a strong specialty crop performance. Again, if you're doing stuff in the Midwest or livestock, it's not the right fit, but if you're doing stuff for specialty crop operators, 100%, love to see you there, Brianna.
Okay, good.
Any other questions?
No, really good.
We will be sending out the recaps of the recording of this, you know, Walt's contact information, the slides, the links that he has as well. So you guys will have all of that as a resource. Is there
a website? Yeah, you know what? Here, hang on. I can go get it for you guys. We got a minute. Let's see. Fury, there it is. Yes, there is. Now, the website is not fully put together, I'll be honest. It's February, or well, it's March now. We'd love it if it were out. It won't be out for a couple more weeks, but I'll put this in the chat. Let's see. October 18 to 20 in Fresno. So the goal is, if FURIA can bring all the European manufacturers they work with over, and if we can bring all the growers, special crop growers over, and if UC can bring all the researchers over, the goal is to get, you know, between 500 and 700 people there for 3 days and really just go deep on specialty crop ag tech.
Yeah.
So we're pretty excited about that one.
I just got an email from Dennis. I'm going to be at the Salinas AgTech Summit too. I'm going to be on the panel there. So are you going to be at that one?
I will be at that one. No, Dennis does a great job with them. Dennis Donahue, my Western Growers colleague, former Salinas mayor, as he always likes to point out. Dennis, fantastic guy. He is a grower. He's got grower DNA in his background, big time. Married a farmer's daughter, grew for a while for a couple different operations. Now on the innovation team at Western Growers and running the Center for Innovation and Tech at the Taylor Farms building in Salinas. So Dennis is great. This event is great. This event is really where we teed up the whole Next Gen Ag Worker Initiative that Karen Ross, the California State Secretary of Ag, is helping us with. We've got four community colleges where the Next Gen Ag Worker Initiative is getting attention at Reedley, Imperial, Hartnell, and Woodlands. That all started from last year's virtual summit with three of our board members saying we need to engage the millennials and the 20-somethings back into ag because we're losing them. And that was the genesis for the initiative, came out of last year's event.
Also, our teams from North Dakota, so myself and my colleague John, and then our team in Topeka, Eric and Lindsay, will also be out at the World AgriTech Summit in March in San Francisco too. So if anyone will be there, I'd be happy to connect, meet up and have a chat if you guys will be out there. So
can you put the info for that in the chat too?
Yes.
Yep. And I apologize. I'm missing that one because it's a direct conflict with the Western Growers board meeting. Someone's going to have to move a date because I hate that those conflict. Here's the link to that one. That's a great one. Abigail and the team from World AgriTech put a great show on. I really enjoyed that show when I've been to it. It's up in San Francisco. Now, I will tell you, it's a bit more investor heavy than grower heavy for crowd, but it's great content and great attendees. It's a busy conference. The last one I'll give you guys, and we rolled out the report here, put this on the radar screen for next year. Let me get you the link. It's in Tulare. This is, as I like to say, CES, Consumer Electronics Show for Ag Tech Geeks. It's World Ag Expo. It's a three-day conference. This is in Tulare in February, generally the second week of February. We exhibited with 9 of our startups from the center in the show. Early results, very promising. They will get in a good year upwards of 100,000 people, even with COVID and uncertainty this year. We didn't get as much Europe as we'd like. We were still at around 75,000 to 80,000 people. So it is a large show, and it is across all disciplines. Dairy's there, beef is there, specialty crops are there, Midwest is there. I mean, if you're in agriculture and you're at all into ag tech, Tulare is a great place to be in February. It may not be 80, but it's a lot warmer than some other places. And I think the going rate, just to let you guys know, the going rate for a 10x10 at World Ag Expo, I believe, is about $1,800. Of course, the real cost is your cost to get out there for a week, and the hotels are not cheap because they know they have a captive audience. So those are a couple of the events I would totally recommend. Got to build that lead funnel.
Yeah, but well worth it for sure, and the connections.
Yep.
All right. All right. Walt has a big meeting coming up. So any last minute questions, comments?
Pretty good.
That was great. All right. Thank you, guys.
Sounds good. Well, thank you for joining and thank you, Walt.
Great.
Thank you, Walt.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Have a great day, everyone.
Enjoyed it.
Bye. Thanks, guys.
Cheers.